Good morning. Let's take a look at what you can have for breakfast today. For breakfast today, we look at eating dates to kickstart your body. Eating a healthy breakfast is essential, but it may not be the best to start your day with a full meal. According to health experts, your body, internal organs, and various processes need time to wake up and kickstart their function after long hours of rest. One of the foods you can have before your full breakfast meal is dates. Dates are a great source of instant energy that is much needed to kickstart your day. Dates also contain a bunch of soluble fibers which are essential for good digestive health because it draws water into the digestive tract. This also helps relieve constipation. The potassium found in dates can also treat upset stomachs and diarrhea. So, before settling down for your full breakfast meal, you can have dates first to kickstart your body and then settle down and eat your full breakfast. That's it for breakfast this morning. I am Jackie Achan.
Government of Uganda respects and takes the freedom of the media seriously. Over the years, government has worked hard to ensure that the media industry in the country progresses without any interruptions. We must remember that Uganda has one of the most vibrant media institutions, all industries in Africa. With over 300 radio stations, Uganda has an average of a radio station at least in every district. We also have several TV stations and online media channels that are doing a great job. Hundreds of journalists work for those stations on a daily basis without any fear of interruption from the state or government. Therefore, the incidents like that of last week are rare and shouldn't define what Uganda has achieved in the media industry. We call upon everyone to accept the regrets from the CDF with an open heart. Let us not criticize him. He came up as the head of institution, gave his regrets, and also pledged to make a few things like taking disciplinary measures and also taking care of those who were affected during the course of their work. So we call upon Ugandans and you, the media people, to acknowledge that he did it out of love and out of passion, because he knows what you do for the country to make the people aware of what is taking place by informing and educating the masses. My ministry will support all efforts meant to improve the working relationship between the media and all the sectors of government to minimize any future conflict. So we shall work together to see how to improve and also how to come up with guidelines that can help us in such rare situations of conflict, of crisis, of covering different events.
That is the Minister of ICT, Judith Nabakova, speaking on the plight of journalists. And while she spoke, the leader, one of the leaders here from the Journalists Association, was shaking his head. Anyway, so good morning once again. Thank you for joining us here on Urban Today. And right now we're going to have a conversation on journalists and the journalists' cause. There's an issue where they're disgruntled. On Wednesday 17th, if you remember, some journalists were beaten by security operatives where they went to cover an event. Subsequently, there was an apology from the CDF, that is David Muhoozi. He apologized. The journalists were like, Then the culprits, the alleged culprits, they're still not very sure that they are the ones, were, you know, paraded, they were arrested, they were sentenced. But still, there's some disgruntlement in there. I have with me the president of the Uganda Journalists Association, and that is Rukundo Mathias, of course, with Darren Bartlett here. Rukundo, how are you, and welcome to the show.
Thank you so much, Lynn. Good morning, viewers. I am happy to be here. I am not far from being an employee of New Vision also.
Absolutely.
I have worked here for 8 years.
Wow.
I am grateful that I'm here to discuss an issue that concerns us, more so as a leader. Mm-hmm. Those that have seen me for the first time, my name is Mathias Rukundo, as rightly introduced by the host. I am the president of Uganda Journalists Association. I am happy to be here.
All right. All right. Good to have you, Rukundo. But let's also take a look at the CDF's apology the other day. Let's have a look.
So, maise wanoku oku wategeza konsonge ya badewojo vandama ulire ava kubidua tu wasasira na yate ndekulua UPDF nimiride wano oku basaba ekisonyiwo ya badensobi ya bantu kinomu era tujja kukola ekisoboka kyonna okulaba nti abakoze ekyabaddewo bavunaanibwa nga bwe kyetaagisa mu mateeka ga UPDF. Tewali abatumye banga bwe tuba tutuma abantu ku mulimu tubaweereza bye bagenderako bye tuyita rules of engagement naye ku luno baasuseewo. So n'olwekyo tuli mu ntegeka ey'okunoonyereza then tulyoke tukole ekiddirira eky'okubakangavula nga amateeka bwe galagira. Nafunye okutegeezebwa nti abantu nga mukaaga wano omusobyo baalumiziddwa nga mulimu Cliff Wamala, Joseph Sabiti, Rashid Nakai, Timothy Murungi, Irina Balo, Joseph Finn Namakumbi, Jeff Twesige. Bano ba mikutu janjawulo baalumiziddwa mu frakaseyo abalala naddala nga Cliff ndoza ne Mulungi bafunye injuries neneko nabadde mbagambye mu Lungereza nti tujja bakwatirako mu byobujjanjabi biruza obujjanjabi nga bwe kyetaagisa mu buntu bulamu tetuyinza kuzza mabega byabaddewo obuvune bwe bafunye naye tujja kugezaako okulaba nti tubayamba mu kufuna obujjanjabi. Naye gye tugenda ebyokuyiga bye tufunye mu kino n'ebirala ebyali bibaddewo kubanga kino kye kisoose omu kumu agambye nti mujja kubanga mukuba ate mukomewo mwenenye ne mugamba nedda naye siyinza kugamba nti tujja kuziyiza okuva kati olwaleero tewali kukola nsobi. Tuli abantu basobya naye bwe basobya kiki ekiddirira? Lesson ndoza gye tufuna. So gye tugenda mu maaso ndoza tujja kufunamu okuwaya n'abannamawulire tulabe tukola tutya emirimu gyaffe nga temuli kukonagana okugikola obulungi buli omu nga atuukiriza obuvunaanyizibwa bwe ffe ng'abasecurity namwe ng'abamawulire. Tu noza tulina okwongera mu package yaffe ey'okusomesa ey'okutendeka okugunjula abantu baffe engeri y'okuyisaamu bannamawulire n'okumanya obukulu bw'abannamawulire. Ekirala tulina okulaba nti tufuna naffe kamera bwe tuba tukola ebikwekweto byaffe so that twogere side yaffe ate n'ekirala kiyambemu accountability omuntu aba akoze ensobe tubere nga tumuyina ku lutambi naffe kijja tutwanguyira okukola okugoberera amateeka okukola emirimu gyaffe mu bulungamu n'oku noku nenya ababa bakoze ensobi mu mirimu ja security ete muri balabe muri muri profession ya mugaso nyo eliyegwanga eliyensi era chitukakata kofenga abebyokwerinda okubera nentabagane nunji ne bana maulidi munna kubiri tujabukwa kutategeza action jetu koze kwabo abakoze mistake eno tujaba kwatirako abalumizidwa mu bujanjabi
Muhozi, apologizing to the journalists and planning a way forward, assuring us that things are going to be all right soon or later. And after his speech, I beg your pardon, he did actually, we saw that the culprits were arrested and put away, given some, they were charged, but journalists were not really amused. Now, Matthias, yes. Let's start from the right now. After all the events of last week, it was the other week, what now? What are you as the Uganda Journalists Association looking at? Let's just start from there.
Thank you so much. Lynn, I think I should also talk about that apology before I get to what we are doing now.
But of course.
I have watched General Muhoozi for a time, from the time he assumed that office. He speaks in a civil manner.
Mm-hmm.
I think him also being a lawyer helps him so much. I appreciate him for the efforts of trying to imply that all is going to be good. But he's not the first general to have come out and mentioned that on TV, saying, mm-hmm. hey, we will help you. He actually, in a way, emphasized the matter and the issue that was echoed by the IGP, saying, we will beat you. We'll go to the hospitals, we'll pay your bills. The next minute you see us, we'll still do the same. So, okay, I want to appreciate him in as far as him coming out. I think he was representing himself, not even the force.
Mm.
But we think that means nothing to us. And as an association, we are committed to the other avenues
mm.
to fight for our rights. Lynn and those that are viewing us now, Wujia has already filed a case in the civil division of Uganda, where we're asking court to pronounce itself on different issues.
Mm-hmm.
Part of those issues, we want court to be moved to pronounce itself on the acts that have been happening, like in all these other events,
mm-hmm.
the acts of 17th. But we've also challenged the court to really go further and investigate. There's been a spell of many cases since November 3rd. Through the election, through the COVID time, that really entirely affected the work of a journalist and those of the media houses. So mm. we're asking court to pronounce itself on those issues. One, to also give impunitive actions to those individuals that go and do such acts.
Mm-hmm.
We're also asking court that should investigate to the extent that journalists have lost work, have lost property, have had permanent damages, have had issues, to the issue that they should also court should also direct for compensations.
Mm-hmm.
But also going forward, Rin, the issue that faces journalists is not in isolation.
Right.
Community of Uganda is facing similar issues, similar challenges under the same governance of President Museveni. So we want to move society. We want to move that society that should understand the cause of journalists. The cause of journalists to the extent that we do not go there to represent ourselves. We go there to represent Lynn and all those that want to follow the issues that are in the communities. We also want to be part of that society that says an informed mind
mm.
is a mind that will also be guided to take a decision that is well informed.
Right.
So we do not go there to represent media houses that we work for. We present the bigger picture of the community of Uganda.
Mm.
In as far as security does its work, we think we have also shared responsibility to give a contribution to Uganda so that we'll be counted in future as a team that also had a cause, delivered on it, but also guided the society to the extent that they can take a decision that are fully guided,
mm-hmm.
they can take a decision that are really informed. So we think our responsibility is as good as theirs. So we think the laws are there to guide each of us. There are laws that guide our work. There are laws that guide the UPDF and other security agencies. We think that what is missing mainly is an issue of respect for everyone's work. We've engaged with these individuals on all levels during my time as a leader, but also in previous engagements, because I've been politics of Abuja for quite a time. Mm. We've met them. They have made assurances to us. We are not going to do this again. Mm. But what surprises us, and we ask the bigger question, really, what is the motivation of these guys? We have, even on 13th, I think 13th, ahead of the elections, the team of Abuja and other leaders of association, different associations from journalists, we met them at Imbuya. We are engaging them to ask them, you know, guys, we know you have the guns. We only have a camera and a pen and a paper to the most. Why do you think we should not work in a manner that you respect my work? I also respect your work. They gave us assurances to the extent that they even wrote some documents assuring us as leaders that, giving us serious hope that all the previous engagements, all the previous issues we've had with you, we manage them. We appreciate them through the election. Okay, there were a little of those, but we think it's something that we should discuss, not as leaders of associations, not even as journalists, but as a community at large. Because this concerns human rights and rights to express yourselves. So I think when we discuss it to the level of merely journalists, I think we lose the fact that journalists are like any other person.
Right.
So we want to move societies of Uganda.
Absolutely.
Those that are in charge and those that watch us. The moment you go to a TV, the moment you buy a radio, maybe a cost of 2,000, and you want to listen to what is going on in the country, just ask yourself, who are these guys that put their lives at risk?
Laying the information.
Yes, at risk so that you get that information.
Right.
So at times of such challenges, we want to hear our bosses. We want to hear CEOs of these organizations. We want to hear communities in itself saying, no, this is too much. Because once you affect a journalist, then you are affecting a bigger community. Because there are those that follow them, there are those that, because many of them, including you and many others, are influencers of society. So what impression are you building in that child who wants to get out of senior six and wants to go to the university to do mass communication? It has become a profession that everyone says now.
I like that you mentioned that. I overheard the parent say, I see my child is interested in journalism. I am so going to discourage this child. There is no way they're going to do journalism. So you mentioned that, and it actually makes a lot of sense. Now, we're joined by Alex Atere. Alex Atere is the treasurer, Editors Guild. Alex, good morning and welcome to the show.
Thank you, and good morning to all the viewers out there.
All right. Now, Editors Guild is one of those journalist bodies that we all ought to know about. Now, Alex, you found us in the middle of, you've met Rukundo.
Yes, I know him.
Yes, this is Darren, my co-host today.
Justice Darren.
Justice Darren, apologies. Now, we are trying to dissect, we're trying to diagonize the situation surrounding journalists. Rukundo here makes a case, says we have engaged these people, but they assure us. They even write down documents and say, we are going to be as civil as possible because you know you have a job to do, we equally have a job to do. The question is, what could have gone wrong? Has journalism, the face of journalism changed? Because the other day they were saying some of them have become terrorists, you know? What do you pick as an Editors Guild, as the Journalists Association? What do you pick from the events that, these are a series of events that have been going on. Yes, not the first time.
Well, thank you. That's a very legitimate question. We all agree that what happened last week was absolutely unfortunate and should be condemned. It was a bit reassuring that the Chief of Defense Forces then comes out with that public apology. It is not the first time, it was noted that it's not the first time that this kind of incident has happened and then an apology is given. Meaning that even with the assurance of the apology, we are not sure that this will not happen again. Because the last time this kind of nasty incidents happened was in August 2018, Again, the journalists were covering a confrontation in town involving protests to do with Bobi Wine, and one of the journalists, or photojournalists attached to Reuters, Mr. James Akena, was beaten out of the job. Today is his birthday. We want to send him our regards.
Absolutely,
and,
yes.
Now, we saw the apology, we saw the incidents, and in the run-up to the elections, several incidents targeting journalists had happened. Now, the Editors Guild is a new body that brings the country editors and senior journalists together and associates within the industry. And we have been working on several issues that affect the practice of journalism. In the run-up to the election, there was a move to, if Rukundo remembers, there was a move to register journalists to accredit journalists by the Media Council, and we thought that was not right. We went to court, and court has agreed with us. Okay. I am happy that in this incident, the Journalists Association are already in court. We are also exploring a legal action to this incident of previously last week. We shall have to review whether to join the petition of the Journalists Association, or whether to do it in the, our lawyers are yet to come back to us with sound advice. Why are we doing that? Why are we looking at that? It's not that we reject the apology of the CDF in its entirety, but we want to look for a permanent deterrent measure such that these kind of unfortunate incidents do not happen. I agree that when these incidents happen, because journalism is a public good, journalists act in public interest. So when these incidents keep on happening to journalists, it is the public. Of course, the journalists are physically affected, mentally affected, emotionally affected, but it is the wider public that loses more. So we need to all work together as people in the industry, individuals in the industry, associations, and work with the public to make sure that these things do not happen again.
Absolutely. Justice Darren, the Fourth Estate has been targeted. I'm using that word. That is actually what they say. Do you think there's a situation going on between the different arms of government? And we know that the Fourth Estate plays a major role.
Well, let me first help Matthias and
Alex.
And Alex, she calls me justice because it's our.
It's just
because anyway, because it's also my profession.
You actually look like a judge.
Don't tell him that he's going to fly without wings.
Yeah, because anyway, that's my profession is in the legal direction as well. I have very deep concerns, and that's why whenever journalists try to sound their issues, I am one of the guys, after a long, I'm fatigued by their complaints when they're not doing anything about it. To hear that they're going to court, I am asking myself another question. That, well, he says to deter the continuous beating of journalists and things like that, but I feel like they are disjointed. Journalists are disjointed, and the reason could be one here. Money. Let me explain it. I've also worked in a newsroom before when I was covering sports with one of the radio stations here in 2009. You're paid per story, and if you don't get that story, you don't earn money.
That's true.
And it is also habitual that most of these conferences that our journalists go to, whereas they may be paid at work, they're also given a token at those conferences, which may include one of those press conferences. That even when they stood at the Media Council and said, we are boycotting this press conference until an apology comes.
I know.
the next day or two, they went back and covered the IGP who said, we shall continue beating you. And they continued attending these conferences. So what are they breathing? I thought when they said we are boycotting, we are not coming back to these things. But because there is some money that flows around there, they go.
I mean, there's a job to do.
Ah, ma, am I? Really?
Let me give him, wait.
I'm going to tell him that one of the journalists who actually led that boycott, he personally said, and it is on record, you can go on YouTube, and he was on one of the channels, because I remember he was hosted on one of the channels on a Friday morning. He said how journalists were invited by a general in Guru, where they went, and there was an offer that was made of money to them.
I can give you information because I surely know about
it.
You see where the issue is?
Uh-huh. Mm. There is money. I have personally been contacted to talk to journalists to attend certain conferences where they, most of them just ask, please give me a press release. Uh-huh, Akange Kaliwa, you give the guy his 50K and he moves
so
on.
Done.
Now, the air they are breathing is quite difficult. I can assure you a new TV station that is starting in this country may not go the direction he wants to go. That let's go to court and agree that we are not covering anymore. We are not covering security agencies anymore. But the security agencies may have prepared Bogoya and tea in a boardroom.
Yeah.
They may not give them money, but the guy slept hungry. He's going to get breakfast there. He will go and cover that story. So they will not accept, they are not agreeing on one thing. I even don't understand, okay, where is NAB in this position? Mm-hmm. I expect these bodies to calm down and say, guys,
where is the Uganda Media Council?
We are not doing this thing.
What is it supposed to do anyway?
You get it, huh? I'm not saying go and boycott. I am saying that I have not seen an action. Because one of the most memorable picture, apart from Akena, one of the most memorable picture I always have in my head is that journalist who was beaten downtown, and you can see his camera was actually...
That's Akena, actually.
No, I think it's different from Akena.
Really?
It's different from Akena. It's another picture. It was taken by a gentleman called Stewart. So every time, I remember he wanted to publish that picture, but he was told not to. You now see the issues.
Mm-hmm.
By a media house said, no, please don't. Mm-hmm. Because some of these pictures then incite more violence. They tend to, there's something they push the trigger into other people.
Yeah,
so some of these images, please don't. Because that media house has its editorial policy that you cannot publish such images. But I remember I saw it. I've seen that picture. Now, if we start that kind of conversation, we are not agreeing on the same thing.
Mm.
I can tell you that even when they go to court, he may go to court as the Uganda Journalists Association, but there is a guy in Kapchora who is working for a radio station who may not be part of this.
He does not
understand what these people do. He does not even understand the impact of the ruling that was made about the registration of journalists.
Mm-hmm.
He doesn't care. You know what he's going to do?
Am I getting paid?
He's getting paid.
Marcus
that
wants
function.
To actually react to that.
Thank you, Lynn. Now, there are three issues I want to talk about. Right. I appreciate where he comes from. And the issue of money cannot be left out without discussion. But let's ask, there's an event he mentions, the one of boycotting, and then the stories are on air, the next minute. So, who betrays the other then?
Yourselves.
Not really us.
Yes, it's you.
Now, let me tell you, Lynn.
Uh-huh.
The government of Uganda has made it the sector of journalism and sort so risky that the people of the stature of justice cannot invest money in this sector. Because what it requires you is that once you want to invest in this sector, you want to do good stories that move advertisers to come and advertise with you.
Mm-hmm.
So once that happens, once they advertise with you, you will then have money and a stronger financial muscle to support your journalists that you hire. So what is the case of Uganda? The case of Uganda is that for you to have a singular story that will attract advertisers in this particular sector, you air it today or you write it today, the next morning it will be closed. You can take an example of red paper.
So what is the problem there?
See,
what are you trying to say?
I'm trying to connect his imagination. That the issue.
No, not an imagination.
Okay.
This is information that is on record.
I'm trying to connect the gentleman's impression to the fact.
Mm-hmm.
The fact is that the moment the state makes it very risky for any investor to invest in a sector, then that sector is either left to the government or left to mediocre about what it does. So once it doesn't earn money, then it can't support its workers. What are they left with is to survive, because survival is a fight for anyone. Mm-hmm. So what happens then? These media houses, mention them, they survive on merely adverts and grants from the government in all sorts. So they fear to stand with the journalist, even if you had a cause that is worth standing with you. So the moment they, because journalists, their reason is go, get a story, brief your editor, and the story will be aired.
And you'll be paid.
And the moment you say, I am boycotting this, and your editor, your boss, your CEO, he's rather thinking, how many adverts are pending to be cleared from Ministry of Sort? They will say, let the stories air. So whether you try to boycott, then how do you shift blame then from the main person who is the boss, who is the employer, who has capacity to say, today we are not going to have news at 9 until the issues of battering giants have stopped? Rin, just give me a minute. Uh-huh. So for the guys who go to an event and then say, Tukoyo kutukuba, we are walking out, and the next minute Rin is calling saying, please, where is my story? Where do you leave that person? How then do you want to blame the person for doing but not holding to what he did? Because you know his capacity is just to do a story. At least I appreciate that they express their feelings.
So
they needed most was the support from their bosses.
Uh-huh. I like that you're mentioning, this is why we have the Editors Guild. Absolutely. Are you saying there's a disconnect between the editors
and the journalists and the editors themselves?
Then, if you allow me to tell you that even the editors, like I'm explaining, they're not independent, because they survive on a salary whose only source is the government of Uganda. You get, in a manner that they come, get adverts, let me just use an example of the Monitor. Alex, don't be offended. There has been a time where the Monitor wanted to stand out and say, I think we will do our work in a professional manner. In several occasions, President Museveni said, these are my enemies. Literally saying, an advert that has been coming from Ministry of Trade, going to the Monitor, maybe of 100 millions, guys are starting to discuss, isn't that person an enemy of the state? And that advert will not go there. So Miss Alex will not even also be able to pay salaries for these kids who go to the field to find the stories. At the level he would wish, he would pay them maybe 50, but if he was able, he would pay maybe a million. So what happens to Alex? He says, because I need my business
need
to survive.
We need to survive.
And the road starts and ends there. Secondly, we would want, even for this event, to pronounce ourselves and say, let's boycott, because it is possible. I was actually explaining to some guys, saying, just imagine Agatari Konfufu at 10, NTV at 1, mention them, and they have that independence to say, there's a cause for journalists, and we're not going to have bulletins at this time until the state comes out to assure us that this will never happen again. The impact that would create would be really an impact that would springboard the future and the existence of journalists. But what happens goes back to what I was explaining, that the moment NTV at 1 says, I am not going to air, or Urban at 9, the newsroom, then they will tell you, some call will come from somewhere, from justice, and say, guys, you're wasting your time. Because even then, reaching that decision requires you to consult guys that are in influence in government.
Absolutely.
So before you know, you cannot do much as a journalist.
I think, Marcus, you have a case.
Rin, let me just, before you go to Alex, there's an issue of unity. Like he hinted
on. Unity disunity.
Unity.
We need
unity, yes. But where does it come from? If there are those that believe in causes, they cannot sustain. We look up to our bosses. You know the hierarchy of journalism and all that. An editor is a very important person. But how many are willing to come out and speak their souls? Some wish were good, others don't even mind, but others are compromised by all the situations I was explaining to you.
Mm-hmm.
So we may not watch so much from them, because we know if they had an opportunity to be independent, we would have them, we would have their support. But it's an issue for discussion, more so unity. You'll hear Editors Guild. This body that I lead now has been in existence since 1963.
Mm-hmm.
You get? Little of support has come from editors. All they would do now is to forge away and have their platform. It goes back to Justice's insinuation of money. They're saying, okay, why can't we support the body that has lived there and has causes that are genuine? But they instead say, okay, which is a good thing, yes, but I wish they had supported Wujia from the start. Mm-hmm. Wujia would have had energies that would not even require other multiple organizations to start, because their cause is clear. The cause is our rights, is our wealth, other welfare, is our general issues that concern as journalists. So I want to appreciate that there's a lot of work to be done, mm-hmm. but also we should be realistic about the issues that surround journalists,
okay.
and be open when we discuss
when
them.
You say we should be realistic and we are the journalists discussing our own issues, who is going to look at those issues? Think about that. Alex.
Well, Lynn, thank you. I think I agree with most of his take on the issues, and I want to put it on record that justice has raised very fundamental issues, and we can only take feedback in good faith.
Mm.
Number one was organization. Which you have discussed as either unit or disunity in the industry.
Mm.
Yes, we realize that the level of organization in the industry has not been at its best. And that's one of the reasons that very senior people in the industry about 2 years ago, they had been on a training program, an international training program in Sweden. Some of those people included the editor-in-chief of the New Vision, Ms. Barbara Kaija. And then they realized that the industry was lacking in general and hierarchical organization. At the very top level, the media owners and the owners were very well organized,
yes.
who can regularly meet.
Mm.
And then at the level of the foot soldiers, and that's why we appreciate the Uganda Journalists Association. It's been there. It's been there in terms of action and in terms of presence.
Mm-hmm.
They have been consistent. We only wish that they can be very consistent in terms of the leadership. Now, that's why then they said now, at the middle level, the managers were not organized. That's why they said now, let's form an editors guild.
Mm.
Then if we organize that foot soldier level, then editors level, and then the owners level, then the industry can actually speak. So that's the reason behind the formation of the editors guild, so that the country's content manager, senior editors, can speak with one voice.
Mm-hmm.
As you see, it's, we have been here for about 2 years, and when we're about to start doing things more robust around formally, COVID came and we have been a bit held back. Now, part of that lack of organization hierarchically is the reason why things like, by the way, boycotts are very problematic. Boycotts should be things of last resort. But if you are not very well organized, as he has rightly pointed out, then boycotts are also very difficult to implement. Because if you are going to do a blackout for a sector as important as security, it cannot be decided at that level of the foot soldiers, right? You need a level of approval from either the guys who run the newsrooms.
That's when the connection.
And the people who own the business.
The that is houses. When the unity.
So that's why we were saying.
The now.
That's why I agree that the industry is not very well organized.
Mm.
So it has been very difficult. I agree with you. It has been very difficult. Like if people have intentions of like a boycott, like to make a security coverage of security agents blackout, it becomes very difficult to implement, because then we are not speaking to each other at
of
all those levels.
Can't.
And now the task is for us to
harmonize.
Continue organizing at all our levels.
Mm-hmm.
Editors Guild, continue organizing and getting strong. Mm-hmm. Owners, that is the Newspaper Owners Association and NAB. NAB is very active. Mm. Continue getting an organized. Then UJA, continue being consistent and continue being very well organized. Now, if you are going to then implement a boycott, you need all the three chambers to speak to each other, and then it can be effective.
I'm sorry to cut you short on that, but it's also a question you need to ponder on. Is there a possibility of the three chambers coming together to actually listen to one cause? Ponder on, and we take a break. We'll be back.